The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Vampire Mama, coming to you live from under a full moon right here in southeastern Louisiana. Hope you folks all had an awesome weekend, and I'm here to help you get your week started off on the dark side. As always, I got some crazy scary legends lined up for you all tonight, but before we get started, let's do a quick recap of last week's show. So we talked about the house the devil built, a haunted penthouse, and a haunted hotel in Kentucky. It was called the Anderson. Remember that one? That's where the camera crew and the investigators kept getting bit by the ghost. We talked about Marie Laveau, too, and I even let you guys in on a little haunted history from my childhood. So if you missed out on the show and you want to find out more about these creepy tales, check it out on Spreaker.com. Got it? Good. Okay, so we got that out of the way. Let's get into some of the madness I have picked out for you tonight. But some of you folks out there might start feeling a little deja vu coming on in a minute. Just wanted to let you know that you're not crazy. Well, okay, you may be a little crazy, but it's all good here. Tonight's show is a redo from the past episode when we had some deviant ghosts in our machine. But my always awesome and mostly sober producer, Jimmy, has beaten those ghosts back into the machine where they promised they'll be on their best behavior tonight. So let's get this party started, right? Okay, so ever hear of the Radiant Boys? No, I'm not talking about some wannabe lame-ass boy band. Y'all know me better than that by now, right? The Radiant Boys originate from German lore. These glowing child spirits are said to have been murdered by their own mothers or stepmothers. And back in these days when the legends originated, this seems to be a fairly common occurrence. So when I first started my research on the Radiant Boys, I was thinking, were some of these women insane or something? Well, that might have been the case in a few select instances, but it wasn't the most common of reasons. Desperation was the most common factor when a mother plotted the murder of their own offspring, whether it be to avoid the shame of bearing a child out of wedlock, or just down to not being able to provide food and shelter for another hungry mouth. Oh, and then sometimes there was the desperation to retain wealth. Yeah, this is where the murdering stepmothers come in. So back in the 1700s, if a man died and he still had living children from a previous marriage, they were the ones that would inherit the estate, not the widow. So as you can imagine, lots of stepmothers start offing those kids, right? It was so common in this era, in fact, that two very well-known fairy tales were based off of the premise, Hansel and Gretel and Sleeping Beauty. So these Radiant Boys, once known in German legend as Kindermorderin, are seen mostly in Germany, of course, but also in Cumberland and Northumberland, England, thanks to German immigrants that shared their heritage and beliefs with the locals. So let me tell you a little bit more about these creepy kids. They're said to appear scantily clothed, and they glow so brightly that they look like they're on fire. They actually appear in full form, but they only stick around for a minute or so before they disappear into thin air. Here's the kicker, ghost hunters. Do not go looking for these ghostly children. Now, y'all all know that I'm all about ghost hunting and paranormal research, but there's more to it than with these Radiant Boys. These little bastards are known to be harbingers of doom. The upside to the encounters means that you're going to stumble onto some good luck and that you're going to become extremely successful. The downside, you're going to die violently as soon as you make it to the top. So I ran across a ton of documented encounters with these evil little kids, but I think the most noteworthy of the lot is this story. So, a once very well-known Englishman known as Captain Robert Stewart had an encounter with a Radiant Boy. He was off on this hunting trip in Ireland, and he lost track of time. Daylight gave way to darkened skies, and the captain was soon lost in the woods. So he stumbles across this little country cottage, and he knocks on the door in search of refuge. The owner, who's already hosting a house full of guests, goes ahead and invites him in and tells his servant to go make room for him. So the servant leads him into this large room that appeared to have been neglected for a very long time. After the servant lights this massive fire in the fireplace, he leaves the captain alone for the rest of the night to get some sleep. So Stewart was so exhausted, he falls asleep real quick, but he's awakened several hours later by this bright, glaring light. Assuming it was the fire, he rolls over towards the hearth, but he sees that the fire has long since burned out. So where the hell's the light coming from, right? Well, Stewart slowly looks above him where the source of the light seems to be coming from. Guess what he saw? He sees this glowing boy ghost hovering over him, just floating in midair, staring directly at him. Then all of a sudden, he disappears. Well, apparently Stewart was, like, really tired, because the story doesn't say anything about him freaking out or anything. The legend picks up the next morning when he's leaving. Captain had some brass balls, right? So anyway, he mentions the boy ghost to the owner as he's walking away. The owner suddenly appears angry, and he immediately calls for the servant that had led him to that room. When questioned, the servant admitted that he had led Stewart to the haunted room, but he defends himself by stating that he had lit a large fire in the hearth to keep the ghost at bay. The owner was furious. He then explains to Stewart that the room had been off limits because it was haunted by the ghost of one of his ancestors that had been murdered by his demented mother. He then warns Stewart that when the ghost appears, it means that the one that who had seen him is going to rise to great power, then die a violent death. The captain laughs off the warning and he goes on his way. Well, shortly after he returns home, Stewart becomes the Viscount Castlebrough because his older brother suddenly dies in this horrible accident. He then left the military and became involved in politics, in which he did quite well. He actually served as the British Foreign Secretary during the Napoleonic Wars. He also served as the leader of the House of Commons. Though he had been successful in climbing up the ranks, he was very unpopular. After several years enduring the pressures of his position, it finally all got to him. He started losing his mind, and in 1822, he committed suicide by slicing his own throat open. And then there's another well-known Radiant Boy legend, the Blue Boy. This kid wasn't murdered by his mother. His death was way worse than that. Legends state that the Blue Boy was found in possession of some documents that were given to him by an aristocrat that owned the Chillingham Castle. The documents were to be given to the Spanish Armada in order to help them defeat the English. So, as you've already figured out, I'm sure, the documents never make it out of the castle. The boy was walled up inside of a passageway while he was still alive. While having some renovations and repairs made in 1920, his bones were discovered, and with them were the documents, along with shards of blue fabric from his clothes. The tips of all of his finger bones were missing. Assumably, the kid tried desperately to claw himself free from his grave. It's been reported for centuries that at the stroke of midnight, the harrowing cries of the Blue Boy can be heard echoing from the stone passageway adjacent to the castle's pink room. When the last of his cries fade away, it's said that a bright halo of light appears near the four-poster bed. If you're lucky enough to be the one sleeping in that bed, you're going to see the ghost of a small boy dressed in blue, illuminated by a bright halo of light. Blue Boy is said to approach the bed and stare at those laying in it, but only for a moment. He then walks away and disappears into the very wall that he was discovered buried behind. Now, I gotta admit something to you guys. There are many, many more stories about Radiant Boy legends, but when I started doing the research on the Blue Boy, I got distracted by all the history and the hauntings of the castle where he was murdered. So guess what? Yeah, we're talking about the Chillingham Castle next. Okay, so this castle has been around since 1298 when it was a monastery. In 1344, it became a fortified castle. That's 719 years, y'all. You know there's some madness going on in there, right? So it was intended as the first line of defense in keeping the Scots from invading England. This was back in the day of William Wallace when the castle was ruled over by King Edward I. So that should tell you right there that there was some pretty much crazy shit going on in this castle. So, of course, I'm going to tell you all about it. Let's start at the bottom and work our way up, shall we? So, as with most ancient castles, there's a dungeon. Oh, yeah. The Chillingham Dungeon is a very small room that's carved from the stone base. Today, you can still see etchings in the walls where the prisoners kept count of the days they had remaining before they'd be put to death. Most of them in the earlier years of the castle fully expected to have both arms and legs cut off, or at least broken, and then to be thrown down a 20-foot hole where they'd be left to starve or bleed to death, if they didn't die from their injuries. Those that survived the fall were said to sometimes eat dead flesh from other bodies at the bottom of the pit. Some would even eat chunks of their own flesh in a desperate attempt to prolong their miserable lives. Today, a steel grate covers the opening of the hole. It's said that if you look down into the darkness, that the face of a young woman will appear to you. This was the last person that was killed here, but I can't find any explanation as to who she was or why she was punished. All I found was that she lived for 3 days before succumbing to her injuries. So, next up is the torture chamber. Oh, yeah, y'all, it's on. There are some sick and deranged pieces of equipment in this little room, and some of them are still in working condition today. This sucker is packed down and built for nothing other than pain and torment. The floor is hewn from the stone and it has a slight slope so that blood would drain away to one side. There's this huge boiling pot. There's implements for gouging out somebody's eyeballs. And then there's these barrels. They're lined with metal spikes on the inside where they'd stuff a prisoner inside the barrel and then roll them around until their flesh was ripped from their bodies. And then they'd leave them inside the barrel to die in agony from their wounds. Then there are these freaky-looking little cages. Guess what these twisted bastards would use them for? This is crazy! They would attach the cages to a prisoner's body and put a starving rat inside. The only way for the rat to escape was to eat his way through the prisoner. That's some deranged shit right there, y'all. Well, what kind of twisted half-breed could even think of this kind of madness, much less see it through? Well, I'm about to tell you. The dude's name was John Sage. Sage was one of the king's most brutal warriors in the battlefield. He'd worked his way up to lieutenant, but one day his leg was injured in battle so badly it ended his days of fighting the king's wars. Sage begged the king to keep him on in some position. The king, quite familiar with his vicious skills and his hatred toward the Scots, decides to name him the Castle Torturer. And Sage loved it. In fact, he reveled in it. He was so into his new job that he even began creating torture devices of his very own. Some of the things this dude did to these prisoners is just unfathomable, even to me. Sage would torture 50 or more prisoners per week for this entire time that he held this position. Every victim would fall subject for him testing and improving his latest means of torment. Sage thoroughly lavished in torturing, but as all good things do, it would soon come to an end. The war with the Scots would soon be over, and his supply of prisoners would begin to dwindle. Furious with the threat of peace, Sage goes into some of the surrounding towns and he begins murdering anybody that he suspects to have been of Scottish descent. When he returned to the castle, there was talk of freeing the prisoners. Yeah, well, he wasn't up for that. Sage rounds up all the men and women and older children from his hordes of prisoners, and he leads them to the courtyard where there's this huge bonfire burning. Well, folks, they weren't fixing to make s'mores, I'll tell you that right now. Sage has all of them tied up and then thrown into the fire. Hundreds of prisoners were burned to death, and guess what was just within eyesight of this massive fire? A window. In fact, it was the window to the Edward room where all of the prisoners' young children were being held. No doubt the ones tall enough to see out of this window were watching on as their parents died agonizing deaths. Those that couldn't see out surely heard their screams and smelled their burning flesh. Just hang on in there, kids. Uncle John will be there shortly to console you, right? Yeah, not so much. Sage was a battle-hardened soldier, and he knew that if he released these children, they'd grow up, and one day they'd come to seek their revenge. Well, he'd be an old man by then. So this evil bastard grabs an axe, and he heads to the Edward room where he begins hacking the kids to pieces. These kids range from maybe 8 years old to all the way down to infants. His heinous act rendered the Edward room into one of the most paranormally active rooms in the entire castle. The chandelier is said to swing randomly. The room has a foul smell and, of course, a very strange atmosphere. Glowing orbs and the faces of terrified children are often caught on film. Their tormented screams are frequently heard and recorded by those that visit the room. Anyway, back to Sage. So, in the torture chamber, there's a torture rack. Remember, we've talked about these. That's when the victim is tied down and stretched from limb to limb, and sometimes even including their neck. So, of course, this sicko has some sexual fetishes, right? Yeah, well, he's got his girlfriend tied up on the rack, and they're having some kinky sex. Well, he gets a little bit too excited, and he starts cranking the gears on this torture rack. He accidentally winds up killing the girlfriend. Hope that shit was good, because that's the last you got. See, his girlfriend's father just happened to be a member of the Border Reavers. This was a badass gang of broken men and outlaws. Needless to say, Dad wanted Sage dead right then and there. The Border Reavers were a very powerful organization that had a vast and very skilled fighting force. Legend has it that there was a meeting between King Edward and the leaders of the gang, Dad included. King Edward was to have Sage killed immediately, else the Reavers would join up with the Scots and launch a full-scale attack on the castle. So King Edward has Sage hanged in front of an enormous crowd of witnesses. Sage was so hated and so feared by the people in this crowd that they start taking souvenirs. They begin cutting chunks of flesh out of his body while he's still alive. It's unknown how long Sage hanged there while he was being mutilated before he finally died. But I think that was quite fitting, don't you? So Sage, anyway, of course, is seen all over the castle grounds and in his truly beloved torture chamber. Because as we know, ghosts tend to return to the places that they love the most. So, next up is the great hall that leads to the chapel and the minstrel's gallery. Now, let me clarify here. The minstrel's gallery is not a room full of PMS and women. This is where the musicians perform. Okay, so back to the great hall. It's a long room with a lot of artifacts on the walls. The most notable are a tapestry, which cold spots are frequently associated with, and a skull that sits on a table in front of the tapestry. The skull is known to move all around the great hall, all on its own, but it never leaves the room. There are windows that line the wall, and they look out into the courtyard where ghostly children are often seen staring in. On one investigation, a small boy, not the blue boy, was photographed in a chair sitting to the left of the skull. Okay, so back to the minstrel's gallery. It's basically a balcony that overlooks the tea room. People have been pushed down the stairs here. Other folks have been overcome by violent waves of nausea or stabbing pains in their head while they're in this gallery. That is kind of like PMS, though, right? Anyway, there's a legend that says when the tea room was being excavated, a massive toad-like creature breaks through a wall, takes human form, and then it disappears. The legend says that it's this creature that's haunting the area today. The chapel, I'm certain, has heard some crazy jacked-up prayers, right? Imagine the soldiers that prayed there before going out to kill or torture the Scots. The walls are covered with weapons of war and flags that the king's men would carry into battle. The chapel was also recently excavated, and beneath the floorboards, they find relics and human bones. Maybe that would have something to do with the fact that cameras and recorders will not work in this room. Most of the time, batteries are drained completely before there's even a chance to use the equipment. Sometimes the equipment just won't work at all. Next up is the Edward room, or more affectionately known as the killing room. Among the decor is this suit of armor bearing a two-handed sword. The walls are covered in other varying types of war weapons and cow horns and flags, but the most notable relic hanging on display in the Edward Room are the documents that were found with the Blue Boy when he was discovered inside the wall. Okay, so we already talked about the Blue Boy. Let's go on to some of the other ghosts that are seen in the castle. One in particular is a Lady Mary Berkeley. She wanders the corridor searching for her wayward husband, Lord Grey, who actually ran off with her sister, dirty bastard. Lady Berkeley doesn't have a whole lot to say, but when she's near, she definitely sends a cold chill up your spine. Another lady ghost is an ancestor of the Grey family. She's been seen stepping from her own paintings and following folks around the castle. There are documents of her having done this since the Tankervilles inhabited the castle. She was seen by both the Tankerville children and their nursemaid. Sometimes this unnamed lady is seen walking around on the grounds today, and she's often mistaken for a tour guide that's in period clothing. A descendant of the Tankervilles, Lady Leonora, lived in the castle in 1920s. She left behind this comprehensive journal of her ghostly encounters. It all began with her as a precognition. While she's in Italy, she has this dream where she's walking along an avenue toward a castle. As she neared the park, she was joined by a young man that introduced himself as her soon-to-be husband's brother. He explained that he must walk with her until his brother was ready. At that time, she had never heard of Chillingham. She had met her husband-to-be only a few months before, and she had no idea where he was from, much less anything about a castle. So as time passes, she actually finds herself at the same castle that she dreamed of. While she's scanning family photos, she had no difficulty picking out the young man in the photos. It was then that she was told that that was a brother that had died many years ago in a past war. The first ghost that Lady Leonora encountered had nothing to do with any of the ancient specters known to haunt the halls of the castle. She was standing at her dressing table one evening, brushing her hair before bed, wearing only her nightgown. She suddenly feels a presence of somebody behind her, so she turns around and she sees this young soldier. Well, she and her husband knew the soldier, and they were also aware that he'd been very ill. She was still shocked to see him standing there in her room behind her, though. She's almost naked and everything. So she spins around, grabs her dressing robe, and holds it up against her, and she turns back around to see what the man had to say for himself for intruding. When she turned around, he was gone. Then she goes to tell her husband, and she's on her way, and all of a sudden she encounters her husband, and he was on his way to tell her that the man she had just seen in her chamber had just died. One morning, the lady had just sat down for a short rest, and there was a storm brewing, and the sky was getting really dark. As she's looking out the window, she sees a woman appear in what she refers to as the garb of a Dominican abbess. The woman knelt down to pray, and when she stood, a man came to stand beside her. Together, they're looking toward the horizon in the direction of their enemies, the Scots. A few feet behind them, two men appeared wearing velvet court dresses from the time of Henry VIII. A few minutes later, a chambermaid came into her room with her. The lady thought that the vision would surely have disappeared, but it didn't. She looked back out the window to see another woman drape a cape over the first one's shoulders, and the man now wore a surcoat. So she says at this point that she calls out to him, asking them how she could help him, not once, but twice. After the second time, the man turns around toward her, looks directly at her. He was wearing the garb of a French from 4 centuries ago, and his face was that of her husband's. During the entire vision, she felt as if she were about to witness some historical event, but as it was, she was actually reliving an exact moment from the past as what she was about to face on her own. Immediately thereafter, official directors came to visit the castle to warn them of an impending invasion. In the library beneath the upper chamber, the voices of two men can be heard talking. If somebody's reading or writing in the library, the ghost conversation continues. But if that person stops reading or writing to listen in, the voices go hush. And then there's this white pantry ghost. So back in the day, there was what they had. It was called an inner pantry. This is where all the silver and the valuables were stored. And there was always a guard that was assigned the task of sleeping in the pantry to protect it. He was locked in there, so there was no way for him to get out and no way for anybody to get in. Well, one night, the sleeping guard was woke up by this pale woman that's wearing white, and she's begging him for water. So he wakes up, and he's thinking that the woman was a lost guest, and he stands up to go get her some water, and then he suddenly realizes that he's locked in the inner pantry, and there's no way out, and there's certainly no way anybody could have gotten in. So he turns around to confront the woman, and guess what? You got it. She's gone. The same pale figure can be seen in the pantry today, still begging for that water. Footnote here, folks. It's thought that the insistent yearning for water is a sign of having been poisoned. Also on the castle grounds is this picturesque and seemingly peaceful lake. Yeah, not so much. Beneath the pristine surface of the water lies the remains of thousands of Scots killed during the war with the English. Their corpses would be piled high on the wooden carts that would be emptied into the lake. Legend has it that the water is so cursed that if you put your hand in it, the spirits of those that rest there will pull you in with them. Impromptu pool party, right? So, anyway, the castle is now presently being renovated by its new owner, which is a tremendous undertaking to say the least. But one never knows what will be discovered while excavations and repairs are ongoing. In earlier attempts to restore the castle, workmen discovered two skeletons, the bones of a man and a child. They were found close to a trap door near the stone arches of the underground vaults. No one knows for certain who they were or why they were there. Some speculate that they'd been hiding during a border reavers attack and may have wound up trapped in their hiding place. Workmen also discovered a small chamber in the lower dungeons. When they opened the wall, they found a perfectly preserved body of a man just sitting in a chair. Unfortunately, once the cavity filled with fresh air, the body crumbled away like ashes. So the castle has so many ghosts that there's actually an on-site paranormal investigation staff. I shit you not. It's no wonder either. The castle's been around for so very long. And there were good times, and of course there were bad times, and some were really, really bad, right? With a record of 18 nights, there were bound to be problems. You know, male egos and all that. There were 8 executions within the family itself. These were brutal public events, too. These poor bastards were hanged. Then, while they were still alive, they were cut down from the gallows to have their entrails removed. And as if that wasn't enough, before their heart beat for the last time, their bodies would be cut into quarters. Their heads would be then hung on the city gates to serve as a warning to others. The luckiest of those to have been executed within the family simply had their heads cut off. They got off easy, right? Okay, folks, so we're rolling up on a commercial break, but hang around, because I want to introduce you to a fellow twisted mind, my friend, beautiful actress, Kim Marie, who has been so gracious to come back and join me again tonight. So go over there, get your drinks refilled, make your pee run, and I'm going to be waiting for you right here at Armed Radio Global and TuneIn Satellite.
Are you hangry? Know the signs. Uncontrollable yelling.
Why aren't you egg rolls?
Hallucination.
Sushi.
Pants discomfort.
I hate you, pants.
Hangry. It can happen to anyone. Fortunately, there's E24, the app that tells hunger to shut up.
Egg rolls. Thanks, Snoop.
E24. In my medical opinion, it's the best way to order food online, baby.
Hey everyone, I want to tell you all about an amazing salon. Joyce's, located at 132 Ferry Street in Everett, Massachusetts. Joyce's specializes in the latest techniques in coloring, styling, cutting, and beach waves. Joyce's features Sukesha all-natural nutrient products and organic color. Joyce's full-service spa and salon, located at 132 Ferry Street, Everett, Massachusetts. 617-387-6688. Specializing in you.
And now, another fresh insight from Roger Berkowitz, President and CEO of Legal Seafoods.
If your wife can't take the time to test your tuna for purity, then why should you take the time to come to a complete stop before letting her out of the car? Just saying.
Legal Seafoods. If it isn't fresh, it isn't legal.
Hi, my name is Amrita Rupnarine, a.k.a. Valenissima. Amrita means ambrosia, or nectar of the gods. Valenissima means the birth of divine knowledge. Join me every Thursday night at 10 p.m. Eastern for a night talk with Joe Rocks, exclusively on TuneIn Satellite on Armed Radio Global Network, where we will discuss food, culinary art, baking, cooking, food preparation and presentation, bringing you a little bit of the divine knowledge so you can create your own nectar of the gods.
Plan your visit to Savina Vineyards in Woodbridge, Connecticut today. It's a family-owned and operated vineyard that grows premium grapes on 8 acres of land and produces a fine selection of wine on-site in a historic barn. Savino Vineyards is a bronze medal winner in the Amenti del Vino International Wine Competition, and wine tastings are only $7. Visit SavinoVineyards.com to find out more, and follow Savino Vineyards on Facebook. That's S-A-V-I-N-O Vineyards. Or call 203-389-2050 for more information.
Everybody's got their glasses filled up. Hope you all made your pee run. Hope you took your time, because we don't need no dirty hands and all that good stuff. But I'm so very stoked to let you guys know that I do have Kim Marie back with me tonight. Kim is my buddy. We met in Orlando, and God, I don't know how long ago, at one of the Spooky Empires, and just kind of hit it off from right there. So what's happening tonight, my girl?
Hey, girls. Good to hear from you.
With no ghosties in the machine other than the ones I'm talking about. That's awesome.
Oh, I know. Huh? They're always fun, though.
It's a challenge, right?
It sure is. So, yeah, we met in Orlando a long time ago.
Yeah.
When I was doing a movie premiere down there.
Which one was that now? I forgot.
That was my first. Well, it was my first film that I ever did. It was my first acting gig, which was really cool. It was a horror movie. I always wanted to do a horror film, and I was blessed that was my first film to ever done.
Yay.
I was only in acting about 2 weeks at the time, and I went ahead and auditioned for a film, and I ended up booking the role, and I booked the role as a drunk alcoholic mother who was very abusive verbally to her children.
Ah,
it was cool. It was fun. I nailed it.
I nailed it.
Yeah, I nailed it. I died in the end. So,
okay, yeah. I was fixing to ask you, did you kill or were you killed?
It was well deserved. I was killed off. So, but it was fun. That's when I had met you down there.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was like my virgin horror con.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of stuff going on down there. I like going to them. You get to meet a lot of celebrities and mingle with a lot of really cool people interested in the same stuff that you are. And, you know, I really like horror. You know, I had started, like I said, I always wanted to do a horror movie and stuff in the acting world. But, then I went to do comedy, which I got to do a few of those. And now I'm really enjoying the drama.
Really?
I really, really love it. I like the intensity of it. Hmm. More so than, I guess, you know, the comedy. Because comedy I kind of do all the time. I'm kind of goofy at home and stuff like that. And, you know, I dance in front of the mirror and just goofy stuff, you know.
You sound like Big John.
Yeah, you know, you get the hairbrush out, you know. You remember those days, right? Bringing out the hairbrush and singing in the mirror and stuff like that.
Vaguely. We were 80s children. I don't remember a whole lot.
Oh, yes, I know. But still, you know, that's what I kind of do that now. But I really love the drama a lot.
And you're doing commercials and stuff now, too, right?
Yeah, I just finished off a financial commercial, which was fun. And that's going to actually be on social media. It'll be on, you know, online. It'll be on television. It'll be all over the place. It's a financial commercial. So that was really fun. I got booked because they really liked my facial expressions. And it was pretty fun to audition. And they like the facial expressions. So.
That's awesome.
and I like doing that. You know, I grew up, you know, back in that time period, you know, Bewitched and, you know, Lucille Ball and stuff like that. And, you know, my dream was to do stuff like that, you know, to be like them and, you know, and to emulate all those faces. And just, I just wanted that so bad. And when I got into acting, you know, I was that person, and they told me, well, you need to be yourself. You know, you need to be you. And I was like, if I wanted to be me, I wouldn't have got into acting. So
that's an oxymoron, right?
I never understood it, and I had to fight it for the longest time, you know, in my career. Like, for a couple of years, I had to fight, you know, being that way, you know, because I always felt like acting was you were acting like somebody else, and, you know, the facial expressions and things like that. And then when they turned around, they said, well, we just want you to be yourself. And I was like, oh, okay.
Wow.
Sure. No problem.
But you bring up Lucille Ball, and I've seen several of your clips that you've posted on social media. I could so see you pulling that role off. I could see you doing that. You'd be an awesome Lucille Ball.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that. I actually wrote a script that is similar to like her genre and stuff, and I'm gonna go ahead and produce that this year. Me and Lee are gonna put that together. It's similar to that. It's just a skit, but okay. Yeah. I'm gonna do something like that. We're also working on a psychological film right now that me and him wrote together. He's a musician, so he's doing a lot of the music and stuff for the film, and he's doing a lot of cinematography, and of course I'm going to be the actress, but we wrote and produced it together, and we did a little testing thing to see how it was going to fly. A lot of people liked it, so we're just going to go ahead and finish it off this year.
Oh, cool.
It got a lot of positive things from people from, you know, showing it a little bit, just a tester. That's all it was. We just wanted to test it out and got a lot of great compliments on it. So we're just going to finish it off, take it to the festivals and do our own thing on that.
That's cool. Yeah, you're not going to have a whole lot of free time this summer. I don't see how you're juggling everything you're juggling right now, but that's a good thing when your career's starting to pop like that. Seems like every other day I see Kim Marie popping up going, hey, I just grabbed this gig or I just got this role. I'm like, Jesus Christ, how is she going to do all of it?
Well, I'm one of these people, I like to do everything that I can. You know, I figured that you only live one life and you need to multitask and do everything. You need to make room for your family. You need to make room for yourself. A lot of people that I've ever encountered always says, well, I can't do a career because I have a family, or I can't do it because of this, or they're too tired or something of that nature. And a lot of times things don't get done that way. So me, I raised my son and he was a gifted child. He's a straight A student, and when he was in first grade, he was doing like fifth grade work. So
wow.
I mean, so and when he was in junior high, he was doing college work, and you know, he took that test, you know, for the gifted program and everything, and he did really well. And I raised him. I juggled my own business at the time, and I also was doing radio for a couple of years starting out at that time as well as on-air radio personality. So, you know, I just feel like, you know, like yourself, you know, with your talk show, you know, you have to do what you love and you have to do it now because it's not going to ever be handed to you. It's not going to be given. You have to go out and get it. And And it's not taking away from your family at all. You know, you have to do what's right for you. And actually, it's a goal because, like, my son looks up to me. My son sees me doing everything, and it's respected. It's, you know, you don't sit on, you know, mom's not sitting on the couch, you know, doing whatever. You know, she's
right.
Coach, and she's trying to make a career and raise a family. You know, and I get my and I have a grandson too, and I get him involved in a lot of stuff as well. We paint outside, and you know, we have fun dancing and making videos together and things like that. And I try to get we actually sat in here the other day. We were listening to actually vinyl. Me and my grandson. I was turning him on. I was turning him on to 78 records, you know, and stuff like that of his great great grandmother singing on them because my mom actually sings.
But oh wow.
So, you know, I try to just teach them all the great things in life that, you know, isn't going on today.
That's
right. Because everybody's so involved with their cell phones and stuff like that. But I'm also working on a film poster, too, which whenever we're done with our interview tonight, I'm going to go finish that off for an indie project. So my point was is that, you know, I do a lot of things. I do radio. I do film. I do posters, art. You know, I did horseback riding, motorcycles. I mean, I've done everything my whole life. Everything I've ever wanted to do, I can say I've actually done. If I had to die tomorrow or something like that, God forbid, but I would honestly have to say I've done everything that I've ever wanted to do.
Oh, that's perfect. And by the way, congratulations on that, because I saw that your artwork had made it to a show. Was it a museum, a library? Where was it?
Yes, it was in the Orlando Museum of Art a while back ago. Yeah, I had three pieces in there, and that was an experience. I had a lot of people looking at it and asking me questions, and that was a really good thing when somebody asks you questions about how your mind thinks and ticks and stuff like that, and you know how you came up with the idea and what it means, and they were just really interested in it. So then I took those pieces to Nude Night as well, and did that show too.
That's awesome. Yeah, people don't really ask me a whole lot how my mind works. I think they're scared. they don't want to know.
I love your mind. I love you. I love your mind. You're so beautiful.
You're funny. That rum and coke's kicking in, huh, baby?
I love the rum and coke. I share some with you.
Oh, that's sweet. maybe in April. Are you going to come do spooky? We're going to make it up there in April.
Oh, you are.
I think we are.
I was thinking about going down there myself because who's going to be down there? I wanted to see. Oh, Joe Cusack's going to be there.
Right, yeah. I've been watching. There's a whole bunch of folks. They're starting to line up, and it seems like the closer it gets, the more people are popping up that are going to be there, so that's way cool.
Yeah, I have a good time going down there. So, but yeah, I always keep busy, you know, like I said, you know, just always auditioning and stuff like that. I have a lot of my stuff on YouTube, my Facebook and stuff like that, things that I do, and you know, I always try to encourage people, so it's not always about me, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I just like to, the reason why I talk about myself a lot of times, really, is because I like to encourage people to do things for themselves, you know?
Right.
And I really just hope to motivate it, so it's like, here, look at what I'm doing. Oh, and my photography, I do a lot of photography, too. I like to connect with nature and stuff.
That's really cool.
But that's why you see a lot of my stuff on there, Lynn. You know, when you see it's like, oh, here's Kim again. Here's her photography. Oh, here's
it's always something different, though, and it's always something so cool. You are an inspiration to a lot of people.
But I try to inspire, you know, and to inspire. It's like, you know, if I can get out there and walk outside and take a walk and get a breath of fresh air, I go out there and I enjoy nature while I'm doing it. You know, I come in the house and, you know, whatever, I clean it, you know, but while I'm outside, you know, I try to, you know, enjoy nature and, you know, stuff like that. So I try to encourage people, you know, to do that, live their dreams and stuff. You know, that's really why I do it, to be honest with you.
Well, I think you're doing an awesome job with it.
Cool, thanks.
It shows.
Yeah. So what are you doing?
What am I doing? Oh, I'm trying to behave, but it's not working. It never does. It ends badly every
Why
time.
Why are you trying to do that? That's not
I don't know.
Fun.
I thought I'd try something new. Actually, right now, I'm just promoting Wicked Truth. I'm not writing at the moment, but that probably won't last long because I don't go very long without starting a new project.
Right.
But just promoting that, doing a little marketing with it, and getting the cons lined up for next year and trying to figure out how we're going to get us and the dragster to most of these cons because they're going to be long rides. But it'll be cool, and it'll work out at the end.
But that's a gift in itself to be able to write like an entire book. You know what I'm saying? I can barely write a sentence. You know what I'm saying? I mean, to write a whole book and a series of them, I mean, that's really, I respect that a lot because that's something I've never really attempted to do. You know, Lee could do that, but I can't.
Well, maybe that could be next.
What, a Kim, book?
Kim Marie's no. Journal.
And then I'll talk it and have somebody else write, do all the writing for me.
Okay.
That's what I'll do.
Okay.
Maybe I'll have you or Lee do it for me.
Well, you know how it'll turn out if I write it. So.
People say, you know, Kim, what can't you do? And I've been saying lately, I can't dance and I can't sing and I can't write a book. That's enough.
Well,
that's
if
about
that's,
it.
If,
but we
if
can't
that's
do
it,
everything, you know. I can't that's do right. everything, you know. So, but that's about it, really, you know.
I think you're doing pretty damn good, period.
Thank you. And a couple of the films that was in last year, I think it was about 2 years ago, they're actually hitting the film festivals right now. One of the films is kind of like Beetlejuice a little bit. I really liked that one a lot. It was really quirky, and a ghost lived in the house with us. And it was done with CGI and stuff like that. And we just put it out the first time out a couple months ago. And it won an award at the Urban Film Festival in Orlando.
Oh, that's awesome. Put that link up later on your Facebook page.
Okay,
I'm
going to
snag that and put it on our Spreaker link for everybody.
Sounds good. A couple of my films are getting out there. Speed Dating, that's maybe the one that you saw where it was like kind of Lucille Ball-ish, possibly.
Yeah.
I was in the wedding dress. That one's actually going. That's been to like 12 film festivals in L.A. and all over the place. Cassandra's in Canada right now at one of the film festivals. And The Wrong Lane has been in a couple of film festivals, too. So there's three of them out there, and they're doing really well.
That's good. I'll keep my fingers crossed tight for you because I want to see you succeed.
Me too. I want to see you succeed. You're already succeeding, though.
and you as well. I don't know anybody that's doing any more than what you are, so that's awesome. Very proud of you.
So last time that we talked, you told me about that car.
Remember the dragster?
That? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do your fans know about that?
They do, actually. There is a page up for it, the Adrian Fury Dragster on Facebook.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Are you bringing that to the Spooky Empire?
I think we're planning on it. We need to talk to Petey, but John said if Petey doesn't have room for it, he may just bring it anyway and set it up at the hotel parking lot because we're going to be guests there anyway.
That would really be cool. That's a hit right there.
I think so. I think people would love it because I've seen Dragula, the Munsters dragster. It ain't
right.
Got shit on this. It's nothing.
I got to see a picture of that. You told me about it. I still have yet to see a picture of that.
Okay, well, I'll send you a couple.
Tag me on that. Tag me on my Facebook because I want to see that.
Okay, well, I'll definitely do that later this evening.
That sounds great.
All right, sweetie. Well, I'm going to hook you up on my Spreaker link, and hopefully we can get some more activities so people can enjoy the Kim Marie experience.
I know. I wasn't really exciting, though, was I?
Of course you are. You're always exciting. You know a little bit about everything, and it's awesome just to hear you talk about your accomplishments and what all you've got going on and what all is coming up in your future.
Well,
it's
I
insane.
Hope that. Well, maybe some of your friends and stuff will check it out and everything. Maybe it could help motivate and inspire some people. That's really my goal in life. Like I said, it's just to inspire people to say, wow, maybe I could try that or maybe I could do that too, you know?
Right.
And
that's right.
That's what I like to do. So.
Well, good for you, girl. And you're doing a fantastic job with it.
Well, thank you. And thanks for having me on again.
Well, thanks for coming back again. I appreciate it. I'm going to have you back again.
I would love that.
Awesome.
I like hanging out here with you.
That's pretty cool, huh?
Oh, and one of your friends, His name's John. His birthday's today. I don't know if he's listening, but happy birthday. He flies the airplane.
Oh, that's right. Happy birthday, John. That's correct.
I think his birthday's today.
It is. He's a very loyal listener, so I'm sure he's tuning in right now.
Well, happy birthday, John.
I'm sure he's just ecstatic now. That's cool.
That was right, my girl. That.
Yeah, well, you did good, and he'll be just tickled to death, I'm sure.
Aww. Well, thank you again.
It was awesome talking to you, as always, and we'll definitely get your contact information up on the Spreaker link later tonight or first thing in the morning, whenever Jimmy gets it out there. But definitely, please come back again and visit with me. I enjoy our time together.
Me too, honey. I enjoy talking to you. Good night. Good night to all your friends, too. Bye-bye.
Bye. All right, guys, I hope y'all were paying attention. Y'all make sure to pay my girl Kim a visit. I'll post directions for stalking her with the Spreaker link a little bit later on tonight on Facebook. Just look me up at Southern Horror Queen. But you knew that already, right? Okay, so I got one more creepy little tale lined up for you. Take notes. This is going to be a good one to share with all your faint-hearted friends that you don't really like. So, we talk a lot about haunted houses on this show, and a lot of them claim to be the most haunted. And, well, here's another one. But this one is pretty badass. It's known as the House the Devil Built. So, the original owners, Charles and Lydia Congelier, built this brick mansion in 1871. Them and their maid, Essie, were all very happy in the new home. Maybe some of them were just a little bit too happy, though. A few months after they're all settled, Lydia finds out that Charles and Essie have been having an affair. Oh, snap. So Lydia's furious. In fact, she's so enraged she loses her mind, and for a minute, she lets her crazy slip out. She makes a trip to the kitchen, gathers up a couple of carving knives, and she went to work on Charles. So pieces of Charles are laying around all over the place, but Lydia ain't finished yet. Yep, she went after that Essie, too, because, well, damn that tramp, right? Yeah, that's right. So anyway, apparently Lydia wasn't able to get her crazy tucked back in all the way after that. And 5 days later, she's discovered sitting on the front porch with Essie's severed head in her lap. I suppose she'd given her a good talking to, right? So after the murders, the house sat empty for a long time. In 1892, the estate was purchased by a railroad company. The home was remodeled and converted into housing for their employees. Yeah, we talk about what happens to haunted houses when they're remodeled. The ghosts get pissed. Well, yeah, that's exactly what happened. The employees complain constantly about blood-curdling screams that are coming out of the walls. There's doors slamming, and they always feel like they're being watched. It must have been pretty intense, because after a few months, all of the workers had moved out, and they refused to go back to the house. So again, the house sat empty, at least until 1901, when it was purchased by a German doctor named Adolf Brunrichter. So, here's where it gets good, y'all. This doctor's a recluse. None of the neighbors ever saw him leave, at all. So, what kind of doctor is he? Well, he's the insane kind. Legend says that the evil in the house possessed him, and he began doing some gruesome experimenting in the basement. He had done a fantastic job of keeping it all to himself, at least up until the night of August 12, 1901. Neighbors were alerted after having heard the frantic screams of a woman coming from the house. So they're like all lined up on the street trying to figure out just what the hell is going on over there. As they're all lined up and speculating, all of a sudden the ground begins rumbling under their feet, and this blinding red light flashes inside the house, lighting up every window. Everything's shaking like crazy. It was so intense that the sidewalks in front of the house cracked, and every window in the house was shattered. A few moments later, when things began to settle, one of the neighbors went to go get the authorities, and what they found during their investigation rocked the community more violently than the tremors that had just shaken the house. Everything was seemingly normal until they searched the doctor's bedroom. In his bed was a badly decomposed female body. It was strapped down and naked. Apparently his ghoul friend, right? I'm sorry, I couldn't help myself. Yeah, that was some freaky shit going on in that bed, y'all. I mean, sicko, twisted-ass stuff, right? Yeah, well, that wasn't all they found. Downstairs in the basement, there were 5 headless women buried in shallow graves. So what happened to their heads? Well, your boy, Dr. Freak Show, had been experimenting, trying to keep the heads alive once they were severed from the bodies. The really mad part, he had been somewhat successful. He was also successful in disappearing, and the authorities were left empty-handed. So again, the house is empty, because nobody wants to live in the place that's racked up that kind of twisted body count, right? So it sits vacant until Equitable Gas comes along and they buy it. And these guys have the intention of housing their workers there. So again, the house is remodeled. That means even more pissed off ghosts now, right? And then they move their immigrant workers into the building. You poor bastards. So, like, immediately they start seeing these apparitions and black shadows in the house, and they're hearing growling coming from within the walls. Day after day, these occurrences were worsening. Some of the workers had been pushed, and there were foul smells that popped up all over the house, and the power would often fail. It all ended just a few short weeks later when two of the workers died. One had hanged himself from the rafters in the basement. The other man, also in the basement, had a large shard of wood rammed through his chest. Needless to say, the house emptied out fast after that, and again sat empty. The house had gained such a reputation for being haunted that it was drawing crowds. Among those whose interest was piqued was none other than Thomas Edison. In 1920, Edison came to investigate the house. He was so convinced that there were really ghosts there that he began building this machine that he had intended to use to communicate with the spirits. Unfortunately, he died before perfecting it. So the ghosts are left to themselves alone in the house to do nothing but grow stronger. People came from miles around to tour the home, and many of them left with some pretty cool stories to tell their friends. But the era of the house that the devil built eventually met its demise. On the night of November 15th, 1927, the house was literally blown to hell. Somehow, a large gas storage tank explodes with a force that shook the whole city. There was a documented damage to homes as far as 10 miles away. Dozens of homes were destroyed in the blast. Not one house in the city had unshattered windows. Out of all the damage and chaos, the Devil House was the only one that not one remnant remained. Nothing from the house was ever found, and not one brick remained. So now the house is gone, the basement's buried under tons of debris, the lot sits vacant for years, and for years there's reports of strange sightings where the house once stood. Today the site is beneath the Route 65 I-279 interchange, where there's frequent reports of young girls walking along the railing and then vanishing into thin air. Well, folks, that about does it for me tonight. I hope you enjoyed the show. But remember, if you need to get your scary on and you just can't wait till next Monday, check me out at authorlynngibson.com, where you can find my books, my blogs, and the link to Spreaker.com, where you can replay all past episodes. All right, kiddos, I'm out of here. But I'll see you right here next week on Armed Radio Global and TuneIn Satellite. Till then, kiddos, keep it creepy, because you know I will. Choo, 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 choo.